Hello everyone and welcome to We Meet at Digital Days. My name is Marie-Therese Kohl and I will moderate this presentation. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our virtual conference. The topic of this presentation is, we backup your application, hot, swappable, supercapacitor backup solution. Our speaker is Frank Puhane. He will hold the presentation and will answer your questions at the end. But before we start, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the presentation. This means that you cannot ask questions via microphone during the presentation. But nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask questions during the presentation at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the control panel. This presentation will be about 30 minutes long. And the chat questions will be answered in a Q&A session following the webinar. There are about 5 to 10 minutes in addition scheduled for this. If we are unable to answer all your questions within this time, we will answer them via email afterwards. And if you still have any other questions left, just mail us at exhibition@we-online.com and we will try to answer all questions promptly. At the end of the webinar, you will be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you take the time to fill out the survey and help us to improve the event. You will receive the link to the presentation in the next few days, and also the recording of the session will be available at our website shortly. But now I will hand over to our speaker, Frank, and I wish you an exciting presentation.
Yeah, hello and welcome also from my side to today's webinar about energy storage device. So we built up a backup application and we want to show you how we did it and what is the specification and what is the purpose behind. So the agenda is as follows. We will have a short roundup about supercapacitors itself. So about the classification of supercapacitors, we have looking about the model and parameters and performance, and also a short look about the charge, discharge, and also the frequency behavior of those products. And then, of course, the main topic will be our backup solution. So we will show this hot swappable backup solution. We will have a short overview about the general information about the design-in process, and also the lifetime of these specific supercapacitors we used. And of course, we will have a short look about the performance of the complete solution. But at the beginning, as I said, we will have a short overview about the classification of the different supercapacitors. And as you see here, supercapacitors are more or less the generic term. Different technologies are called supercapacitors. The most common one, the most used one, is the EDLC, so the electric double layer capacitor. We use activated carbon as an electrode material. There are also different other possibilities, but also activated carbon is the most common one. Then there are technologies like the pseudo capacitors and also the hybrid capacitors. But to say the distinction between those technologies is made of the design of the electrodes. Yeah, when we think about what makes supercapacitors so super, so it's more or less the charge and discharge behavior of these technologies is unique. You can really fast charge and discharge those products. You have really high cycle life of around 500,000 cycles. When you compare the power output, it's around 10 times higher than a normal lithium-ion battery. But of course, there are some trade-offs of this technology. We have a low energy capacity. It's around 30 times lower than the lithium-ion battery. When we calculate the energy and power, what is possible with this kind of products compared to the batteries, you see that we, in the end, we have a lot of power, what we can supply, But for long-term storage for energy, when you compare what is possible to the here small battery, it's not a really replacement of this. Compared to traditional capacitors, of course, they are also capacitors and you can charge and discharge them very fast, but you have a low, also here low energy capacity and higher power output, but the capacitance values for the normal capacitors are limited, going up to maybe 2 millifarad. And for supercapacitors, we're talking about 50 farad, 350 farad and so on. Yeah, so this is how supercapacitors looks in reality. What you see here is a cross-section of a supercapacitor. When you compare this to a traditional capacitors or electrolytic capacitors, they look quite the same, but this is just for the first look. One of the important properties of a supercapacitor is the large effective electrode area. This is obtained by a porosis activated carbon. So this is electrode material. This large electrodes area provides also large area for the ions. And an enlarged area means that we can store more charges at the interfaces. And with that, we can store more energy inside a product. And this layer of charge that forms is then again balanced by a mirror charge, so-called mirror charge. And this behavior was initially studied by Helmholtz. And he developed also the theory for describing this phenomena. And of course, to honor him, this is called the double layer, also called Helmholtz layer, what you see here inside. So the main parameter for energy storing device are charging and discharging time, as well as the power and energy capacity. So what we have for our parameters, we have the rated voltage. For our products, it's limited to 2.7 volt as in rated voltage. So as you see here, for non-aqueous electrolytes, it's around 2 up to 3 volt. So we are quite near the border, but of course, 3 volt types are also possible. We have our capacitance as a main describing parameter. With capacitance and rated voltage, we can calculate, for example, the energy, also the maximum power output. And with the ESR, we can calculate the characteristic RC time. It's quite low for the, as the ESR is quite low for the product. And of course, at the end, we have some leakage current or the leakage resistance or isolation resistance. This defines the leakage current. And also this defines long time storage capability of the product itself. When we look when we compare the charge and discharge behavior for the supercapacitors with batteries in general, the charge and discharge current for the EDLCs or supercapacitors are quite higher than for batteries. What we see here is that we charge the supercapacitors via a constant current. So this is why it's linear here. The voltage drop, what is indicated here, comes from when we start discharge the supercapacitors because of the ESR, there is some voltage drop, and then the voltage falls further linear because physics don't change and the supercapacitor is still a capacitor. And this is why the voltage falls linear here. Batteries in comparison has an almost constant cell voltage at a constant current operation. Yeah, this was our short roundup about the supercapacitor itself. And now we go more in detail about the application itself. As you see, we used an analog device IC for the voltage regulation, our demonstration. The IC have some advantages and very nice features like this hot swappable function and also high power capability. What we want to have 30 watt for at least 15 seconds. So we designed 12 volt and 2.5 amp at the output. Also, what further advantages are this high efficiency step down converter. The IC has some special charging for the supercapacitors. Also, it's a step up converter inside for the backup mode. And also it has some interfaces for the data transmission, so you get some telemetry out of the IC itself. So it's quite nice product here. One word or a few words about the hot swap or hot swap and hot plug. So the words are often used in a similar way. And of course, this feature of this hot swap is necessary that something on the right side, what we see here, is not happening, so that when you really plug in the device and when you have capacitor as a load, then it's in like a short circuit, and the electronic have to handle it very well. So when we look more in detail, hot swapping is the replacing and or adding components, so no shutdown or stopping of the running system occurs. And this is also done by, for example, by pre-charging through special pins when you have some interfaces, or also some current limiter or soft start peripheral to achieve this hot swap. Hot plug or hot plugging describes more or less only the addition of components that would expand the system and have no significant interrupt to the system. So what you see here is the specification of our application. As I said, we use the special IC from Analog Device. We have 24 volt in the input and output rail. So in normal mode, we have 24 volt in input and also 24 volt at the output. When there is some backup operation, we have 12 volt at the output. We decided this so because it's less than the 24 volt, but it's still 12 volt is industry voltage, and we thought, okay, to indicate that there is a failure with this voltage, the whole system can go in a shutdown mode. For the step down mode, for the supercapacitor bank, we use 4 supercapacitors in series, and the voltage is up to 10.6 volt. We can go even a little bit more higher with the voltage, but for safety, for some safety margin, we decide we stop with 10.6 volt. And there is no direct supply from the capacitor bank to the output, because our output voltage is higher than the capacitance voltage, capacitor bank voltage, and our switching frequency is around 450 kilohertz. And the input current limit is around 2.5 amp. It's defined through the IC itself. When we look at a discharge mode, it's in constant power, and the supply supplies the load and also charge the supercapacitors in the same way, same step. And to show that we operate here in a really high efficiency region, just those two diagrams. So we are around here in the region 90%, and also the boost mode, and also the charge efficiency from the supercapacitor bank is quite high. So we are really in a high efficiency region. Yeah, so let's dive deep into the setup, or into how the demonstration really works. So for the example begins when the input voltage and the capacitor bank voltage is of course 0 volt, then there's someone plug in the application in the power supply, and this is called with this label with this hot plug here. Then after this hot plugging, there's a very small inrush current into the drain capacitance of the hot swap FET. So this is here. And then the spike is really small or in duration amplitude, and depending on the rise of the rise rate of the input voltage. During this the debounce time, the IC qualifies the input as a good. Therefore, it's using the undervoltage lockout and overvoltage comparators, and there's an input debounce time which goes down. And once this is passed, then the IC begins turning on the hot swap FETs to charge the capacitance on the output side in a really controlled way. And during this time, the input current also rises to the same rate of the output voltage. And as I said, they are both really controlled. This results in a low constant input current while the output capacitance gets charged. And once the output capacitance are charged and the output voltage is stable, the IC starts to charge the supercapacitor bank. So this is this one here, this is the output here stable, and here starts rising the capacitor bank voltage. So the current is here provided. The first charging phase is the constant current charging. So the supercapacitor bank gets charged with a constant current. When there's a certain limit threshold reached, there is an it charges with a constant power, more or less. And then when the capacitor bank voltage is read, it goes in a constant voltage charging and also in balancing. So the IC or the application keeps the supercapacitor bank in a charged and in a balanced way and waits there for error until some power failure will occur. Then the application changed. So the voltage goes, output voltage goes down to the 12 volt and then provides the application with energy as long or depending how much energy we need until the supercapacitors are empty. So, but now going back to the really interesting parts, so the passive components, how to choose especially the supercapacitor. So the backup situation is defined due to the application itself. So therefore we have some design in process for the supercapacitors. There are more or less four steps to design in. So first we choose the mode of discharge. So we know from the application it's in constant power. We calculate the capacitance. So we need the operating time, output power, and the output current. So we know we want 30 watts, 12 volt, and 2.5 amp for at least 15 seconds. With this, we can calculate we need 450 joule. And when we know how much energy we need, we can calculate the needed capacitance. The 2 volt is our cutoff voltage, and the 10.6 volt is our maximum capacitor bank voltage. So as you see with this definition, you can also change the needed capacitance. Then we have to identify the charging process. So what the IC does is very good. So it's first constant current, then constant power, then constant voltage. So this is the ideal state to charge supercapacitor to get most energy in. And then also calculate the charging current. So the highest possible current provided for the IC is 6.4 amp. So no problem for the supercapacitors. You can charge them with even more current. So one word about when you want to know more about the process and the information. So please have a look at our support node, the SN009, and also the application node 077 to get more information. The supercapacitor itself are all measured and stored or available in our online tool VedExpert. So I put here the link to the module. So we provide different graphs here, for example, the impedance, ESR. And yes, the frequency range is really that low. So this is no failure. This is really measured down to those frequencies. And we provided this data for you, and you see the impedance in ESR quite low. And also another interesting thing is the maintain voltage. So it means how good the supercapacitors can store the energy. And as you see here, there are different graphs. So we pre-charge supercapacitors for 8, 24, or 72 hours. And what you see here that when the supercapacitors are longer under voltage and can longer be charged inside, the resulting voltage, so the self-discharge, is less. So as you see here, 72 hours, after 100 hours, you still have 2.55 volt as a voltage. And when you just charge 8 hours, you have just 2.3 volt. So this is also an interesting factor, and we place this information in our online tool. Yeah, having a closer look to the supercapacitor bank itself. So as I said, we put 4 supercapacitors in series connection. The total amount of energy is around 702 joules, so quite more than we need. But we need 4 to get the voltage what we want, so the overall voltage. The maximum provided power is really high. It's around 2 kV, but of course also the infrastructure and all the PCB tracks and so on has to be capable of this. So this is not what we are using. We just use the 30 watt, and the ESR for one supercapacitor is just around 2.23 milliohm. So on the board itself, there's no balancing because the IC has integrated active stack balancing. And what you see here with this switch, and there's also some resistor here, is for active discharging of the bank. The layout looks like this. So here are the capacitor, here are our discharging circuit. And what you see here is just for a little play around with an Arduino to display the data through an display. So this is not needed here in this situation, because the IC do it by its own. Yeah, one word or one slide about the balancing. So balancing is really important. What we want to show with this example here. So we have really quite high tolerances. And when there are the tolerances take place, then it could be that we get, for example, for an 10 farad type, the 13 farad here and 9 farad. And therefore there is some really disbalance of the whole system, and so we get some overvoltage here. So at worst case there is more or less 3.2 volt, and this is too high for a 2.7 volt type. Of course there's some space to go higher with some surge voltage, like called, but this is for the supercapacitors, for example, 2.85 volt. So this is quite less. So the 3.2 volt are not really good. For this topic, we also had some more information for you. When you want to have more information about it, we have a webinar. It's called We Keep the Balance. It's about the different technologies and techniques about how to balance the supercapacitors. So we have also lifetime above for this kind of products, for the supercapacitors. So they also lose capacitance as they age. In addition, also the ESR will go up due to the aging. We have a really good overview about these topics, and we created and defined our tools to calculate a lifetime. This is shown in those two diagrams here. The left one shows the remaining capacitance after at least 10 years, depending on which operating temperature the supercap is used. So as higher the temperature, the more capacitance we lose. The right diagram here shows the same information, but in a more, sophisticated way, because we also take into account the applied voltage. And so the loss of capacity, the aging, can also be compensated by the IC. For example, if the bank voltage of the supercapacitors is increased, with increasing the age. So this is also some feature of the IC. And this data we provide for more or less every type of supercapacitors we have. Yeah, to show the lifetime, we created also some use case, especially for our application here. So we decide we have 10 hours at 40 degree at 2.65 volt, 2 hours at 40 degree and 1 volt, and the other 12 hours are no operation. So we have a bank voltage of around 10.6 volt. So this leads to a single cell voltage of 2.65 volt. So we have the defined mission profile with around 40 degrees, max voltage 2.65. We use the 4 55-watt supercapacitor in series, leads to a total capacitance of 12.5. We have a tolerance of -10%, so we have at least 11.25 farad. And after 12 years of operation, we more or less halved the capacitance. So we have 5.6 farad. And what we calculated before, in the few slides before, we need 4.2 farad as a minimum. So we are still safe after 12 year operation. We are still inside the needed energy to provide the backup. And the lifetime definition of the product, or yeah, of the product itself, is at the end of lifetime, we have -30% of capacitance and 2x ESR. And the lifetime depends on voltage and temperature. And we don't consider the current at the moment, because current increase self-heating, and therefore we have the temperature again. But we are also working on this kind of math to bring inside the model. Yeah, to show you how this is the voltage and the temperature affects the lifetime, we created these two use cases here. So it's the same emission profile, but the cell voltage is just 2.3 volt. So you see here the same emission profile. And after 12 years, we have still 75% of the capacitance. So we just lose 25% of capacitance. So we are way better than the one before. But of course, we do not have the high voltage available. And when we have a look about what is the effect of the temperature, so 65 degrees is the rated operating temperature for the product. And when we use this, so when we go high with this temperature, we see after 12 years, we have more or less no capacitance left, or really low capacitance left. So this is a really big influence of the lifetime is temperature. And therefore, for example, when there are also supercapacitors available with 85 degrees, but there is not allowed to apply 2.7 volt as a rated voltage, the rated voltage for 85 degree is 2.3 volt. So then you have to decrease the voltage. This is some trade-off we have. Coming now to the demonstrator, what we build up. So of course, maybe you cannot read it really well, but I want to show the complete schematic here. So really interesting is for us, here is the connection of the supercapacitor bank. Here you see then the balancing resistors and also the input for the to monitor all the voltages and so on. This here is the input and output capacitor of the buck boost converter. Also here with MOSFETs and polymer and so on to have really low ESR and parasitics. And then of course we placed a filter at the output and the input. So depending on which kind of operation the demonstrator works, it's either in a buck or in a boost mode. So buck is critical at the input, and boost is critical at the output. So therefore, we place the filter to have also a really good EMI behavior. The device itself, so the PCB itself, looks like this. Just want to show you. So here's also some indicator about the charge of the bank itself. This is the input-output capacitor. Here's the output path, our filter here, output filter input here. And here we connect the supercapacitor bank. Yeah, of course, we need to finalize the demonstrator. So here is our supercapacitor bank. We connect it. And when we have our normal operation, so rail and charging, so the application provides the 24 volt here. And also charging with the 10.6 volt, the supercapacitor bank. And when there's a power failure, then the voltage is provided via the supercapacitor here and this backup path, and with the 12 volt at the output. Yeah, to convince engineers, it's always good to have some measurements, to show some measurements here with an oscilloscope. This is the charging phase with load. So what you see here, or what I want to like point out, this is here the charging phase, and you compare it to the to the theoretical picture here from the data sheet from the IC. You see there's a different. This is because this is theoretical and this is the practical. This is the real application, and there will be some, because of the parasitics and everything, there will be some more current flowing, so it will be slightly higher than in the data sheet, but this is because it's a real application. And when it's charged, of course, the voltage here goes down. This is the charging without load. So when there's no load connected, so no 30 watt, of course, then the charging is quite faster. And when there's the power fail event, also it's the same shape, because we still wanted 30 watt from the application. Yeah, so this is the combination of the charging, discharging, also with load and without load. And what you see in this red bars are the discharging phase. So it's the same as here when there's charging with load. So this is also quite the feature from the IC to manage this. Yeah, so in the end, I would like to have a short recap about the application. So we built up an really backup solution in a size of 10 by more or less 20 centimeters. So it's quite compact. Of course, we can do it even more compact. We have an input voltage around 24 volt, backup voltage 12 volt, output power is 30 watt, 12 volt and 2.5 amps. We have a support node also for the design-in process, and we are currently working on an evaluation kit or on design kit from Virtual Electronic of this kind of application. Hopefully it will be available soon, so then you can really play with it to see if this fits for your application. So stay tuned, and it will be released. And of course, we support your design to help with every question arises within the process. So thanks for joining this webinar. I hope you get some insights or information you can use. And I would like to have to answer your question now or also later in private conversation or whatever. So thanks.
Yes. Thanks to you, Frank, for your interesting presentation. As you already mentioned, we would like now to turn our attention to your questions. So feel free to enter them in the question window and then Frank will answer them. Let's see what's coming in. Maybe one first question. Is there a plan of adding lifetime calculator of a supercapacitor to RedExpert?
Yes, indeed. We are working on this. So as I said, we have the lifetime model and the math available. At the moment, we are working on a lifetime calculator about the aluminum electrolytic capacitors. And when these are ready, this module or this application, then we will start with the supercapacitors. But when there are some requests, as I said, we can do these calculations with your emission profile, please get in contact with us and we can calculate what is the resulting capacitance and what capacitance do you need for your application.
Sounds pretty good. Another question, are there such curves as capacity versus lifetime depending on temperature and voltage also for ESR versus lifetime available?
At the moment, no. So we know how the ESR change over time or also over over the lifetime. So we said it's you can calculate with 2x ESR at the end. But these kind of curves to measure it take a while, so they are under preparation. And when they are ready, we also distribute it. So when you are interested in, please contact us, and we will discuss it in we will discuss it and show you later.
Cool, thanks. Another question, are negative voltages critical?
For the supercapacitor itself, I have to say no, because it's the supercapacitor itself is built up in a really symmetrical way. So more or less there is no polarity, but of course there is polarity. So the electrodes are built up in a slight different way. But when there are negative voltages, it's not really a big deal for the supercapacitors. But of course, I have to say you have to stay inside the specification data sheet. So, but when there are negative voltages, it should be fine.
Perfect. Thanks. And maybe one last question. What is the maximum voltage or step up ratio from the stereo converter?
So I think you mean what is the maximum output or input voltage? Honestly, I have to look it up by myself in the data sheet, but I think it's 48 volt for the input, and as you can do it also for the output. It's really good IC, but I have to look it up by myself. So please feel free to check the data sheet from the actual data sheet from the vendor itself to get the precise information about it.
Sounds good. Perfect. Thanks, Frank, for answering the question. I think if there are any questions left, we will answer them via email afterwards. And thank you all for your attention, and we hope you enjoyed the presentation. The next presentation topic is back to basics, specifying quartz crystals and oscillators. And the session will start at 5. So feel free to join in here, and have a nice day. Goodbye.
Bye.